Discarding even the bag of chocolates and the novel, I climbed into that hovel on wheels, the second-class smoker, praying that fate, the irrepressible joker, would grant me release, permit me the hypnotic peace of wheels clicking on rails for a few beautiful hours. But by God, who should be there, who by God's grace, but the fat, spent woman with a face bitter as a holy war, she whom so often before I had met in my stifling crayfish dreams, waking with screams. And with her the grim wolf jaw, husband, escort, paramour, or fifth limb, with the orange and chocolate blazer and the smart Alex shoes. Her voice was like a razor at the throat of quiet. She was slanging the foes of justice. The trouble was there hadn't been a hanging, and when it came to murder, she was no latitudinarian, and definitely not a vegetarian. The faintest stink of blood made her feel good. And even her mental picture of the gallows action appeared to give her some strictly biological satisfaction. But a spoil sport cabinet had stepped in and stopped the fun. Don't you reckon they ought to put him on the end of a string, the murdering bastard? Don't you reckon and let him swing? I'd like to do the job with me own hands, the slob. And by God, if they'd let me so, I would. I'd fix his lordship, I'd fix him good and proper and let him rot. But they haven't got the guts to slip a noose round his dirty ears. Hell, in 20 years he'll be running around again loose and none of us safe at night. He'll have the run of us just because of a few bastards in Wellington. And you... you don't believe in religion, do you? Wheeling on me, with acid relevance, and I feeling I was in some sense conniving at a threat to this poor woman's life and honour, I couldn't get a word out of my mouth, and felt very much to blame and overcome with shame. Oh, Mr. Tennyson, your dream of fair women, how it echoes remotely at this late date.